Vive la nation!
Hello, I am Polar History, and welcome to the French Revolutionary Wars. Today, we are covering the First Coalition Part 1, and in this episode, we will be covering the years of 1792 to 1794. I will assume that all of you know the events of the French Revolution, including the storming of the Bastille and the Declaration of the Rights of Man. If you don't know, Oversimplified has a great French Revolution series that you must watch. This is such a complicated topic that I cannot cover it in this video. I may do a future video on it though. Sorry in advance for any mispronunciation, I'm just not a linguist. 20th of April, 1792. The French National Assembly, under the newly appointed Foreign Minister, Charles-François Dumouriez, voted to declare war on Prussia and the Habsburgs of Austria. This was a preemptive strike due to Habsburg Austria and Prussia's newly formed alliance to bring back the king into power in France. Their alliance was formed at Pillnitz in Saxony. Their respective monarchs, King Frederick William II of Prussia and the Holy Roman Emperor Leopold II of Habsburg Austria, threatened an invasion of France if the revolutionaries continued to revoke the French king's power. They also discussed issues with Poland, which I'll get to later. The Allies, Austria and Prussia in this case, their goal was to crush the revolution and bring back the French king back into power. This would be done with an Allied invasion of France through Belgium and the Rhine, taking Paris and bringing the King of France back into power. Sound familiar? The first target for the French was to strike and take the Austrian Netherlands, today known as Belgium. This has been the goal for France since Louis XIV, also known as the Sun King. First, the French strategy was to link up Bourbabaisian and Liegeois revolutionaries and crush any opposition. They would continue fighting and spreading Republican ideals. Yes, Belgium does in fact play a role in this part of European history. The Bourbaisian and Liegeois revolutionaries rose up a few years prior, inspired by the French Revolution in 1789. But their rebellions were crushed, but some of the remnants of their leadership remained. They formed the Committee of United Belgians and Liegeois, and they fought for an independent Belgian Republic. This was the birth of a new Belgian identity for these oppressed people. There were three French armies on this Belgian front. The Armée du Nord under General Rochambeau of Yorktown fame. The Armée du Centre under General Lafayette of American fame. And the Armée du Rhin under General Lucquenaire, a Bavarian under French service. I hope I pronounced those correct. Now the French army was in a miserable state at this point. Its ranks were filled with sans-culottes radicals. Many regiments had royalists among them, and many battalions were filled with veterans and newly formed volunteers. This miserable, unorganized state can be evidenced through the uniforms. As you can see, the old pre-revolution regiments were white. Their coats were white, the symbol of the monarchy and the standard color of the French army since the 16th century. These regiments were better supplied, but were confused for which regime to support. Not to mention, many of the royalist officers fled the country or were executed. Many of these men deserted to form a new royalist army to fight the Republic. This would be known as the Légion de Gand. The newly hastily formed volunteers wore the revolutionary blue, and many had no shoes or flints for their muskets to fire. And you need flints for a musket to fire. So,
bruh.
They had unexperienced officers who were previously artists and traders. Many would prove themselves unworthy of command, but many would also prove themselves to be generals and leaders. This would be a first. The average common man could work himself to become this brilliant general. This was unseen for the time, for as many nobles had to buy commission in order to be a general in the army. Also around this time, the French anthem, De La Marseillaise, was written and became a favorite for soldiers. The First Campaign. The French would strike in the Austrian Low Countries, attacking Austrian positions right away. General Rochambeau believed that the state of the French army was simply too miserable to fight, and he was correct. When the French army attacked, they performed very poorly. Rochambeau's orders were to take Quivain, Mons, and Brussels. Rochambeau sent General Biron and General Dillon to command this invasion. Dillon commanded a small French vanguard and had orders to act as a decoy to the Austrians, while Biron led a larger force to capture Quivain and Mons. As Dillon advanced, he faced enemy troops willing to give a pitched battle, and as he had orders to avoid a battle, he retreated. But then, Austrian cannons fired at the French, and although out of range, it caused panic among the troops, and the retreat returned into a chaotic rout. The French cavalry crying out, "Sauve qui peut, nous sommes trahis," or "Every man for himself, we are betrayed." Dillon tried to rally his troops, but then he was shot by one of his own men. His second command was taken by his own troops, hung, and shot out of a cannon. The wounded Dillon was then taken on a cart and then bayoneted, then his body was thrown into a fire, and thus ended the battle. Jeez. Meanwhile, General Biron had a few minor skirmishes that were victorious around Quivain, but then he judged that his troops were not strong enough to take Mons, so he decided to retreat. Then a false alarm of Austrian troops caused the retreat to turn into a disorderly rout, and thus ending the Armée du Nord's ability to fight. Now, these disasters led to Rochambeau resigning and Lafayette refusing to attack. And then the Belgians, they felt betrayed. They thought that the French army with their superior numbers could easily overrun Belgium. But the French did not. They retreated. So, why did the French perform this bad? Is the French surrender myth true? No. There are many factors to the French army's inability to fight during this time. The troops distrusted each other, with the white uniformed veterans disliking the new crazed blue uniformed revolutionaries. These troops didn't trust the generals, and thought that having generals in the first place was not compatible with the French revolutionary idea of everyone being equal. The generals themselves also distrusted the French government, with Lafayette and Rochambeau being notable monarchists. The invasion of the Belgian provinces and Liège at the end of April was the fiasco, and another in June also failed. The troops directed against Belgium for fewer than the war plan required. Morale in the ranks were low, and discipline was almost non-existent, because so many officers had immigrated and many who remained in French service had given evidence of dissatisfaction with the Patriot government and its war plans. The soldiers lacked confidence in their commanders, and the officers were reluctant to rely on their own troops. Even before the French and Austrian forces could meet in a general engagement, the French formations had to be withdrawn from Belgium for retraining. In May, the French troops regrouped and reorganized, with three armies being turned into two, commanded by Dumouriez and Kellermann. In June, the invasion restarted, with a 20,000-strong army led by Luckner, capturing Menin and Kortrijk, but Austrian General Billow counterattacked, forcing the French to withdraw to Lille. While the French repeatedly failed in invading Belgium, combined armies of Prussia, Austria, and many other German states were forming and organizing on the Rhine. They were also joined by French emigre armies. This combined army would be commanded by the Duke of Brunswick. There were three main Allied armies, but altogether, the King of Prussia was their supreme commander. In Italy, the Piemontese were getting ready for an invasion of South France, and in Belgium, Austrian armies were getting ready to besiege Lille. The Allied armies' goals were to reinstall order and the French king back in his position, and possibly gain territory and money after the war was over. In Paris, the French were panicking, and 100,000 National Guards formed ready to defend Paris, the hotbed of the revolution. This invasion would start with the Prussians giving a warning to the French people of Paris that if the royal family were harmed, that Paris would burn to the ground and civilians would be harmed. This was termed the Brunswick Manifesto. But Brunswick didn't actually write this. This was written by the Prince de Conte, the leader and general of the French emigre army. But the Duke of Brunswick took the credit though. The manifesto was sent to Paris after the French king and queen approved it being sent. The French people treated the manifesto as a joke, and instead of being in fear, they were furious, and the support of the revolution amped up. Support for the king and queen faltered, as people were finding out and now believe that Louis XVI was collaborating with the Allies. The manifesto helped fuel the insurrection of August 10th, which led to the storming of the Tuileries. A random French artillery officer also happened to be there. He might play an important role later. Anyways, the war had escalated, and Europe would not see peace for more than 20 years. The Prussians continued their march, capturing key French fort towns. They captured Longwy and its fortress on the 23rd of August. Dionville would be besieged on the 24th. Verdun was one of the most important fortress towns guarding Paris, and was besieged on the 29th. But with low morale and a fort that was just not ready for a prolonged siege, Verdun would surrender on the 2nd of September. The commandant of the fort, Colonel Beaupère, would shoot himself in despair. News of Verdun's surrender came to Paris, and people in Paris started panicking. Paris was now in danger, and Paris was the center of the revolution. Paris needed to be defended. The people in Paris were so full of fear and panic that they stormed the Paris prisons and killed as many political and non-political prisoners as they could, in fear of them collaborating with the enemy, and also fear that when the prisoners are liberated, political prisoners, they would avenge themselves. Now, Dumouriez's army that was planned to invade Belgium jumped into action. He swung south to stop Brunswick's advance, and as Brunswick was advancing into the heavily wooded Argonne, Dumouriez had seized five main roads to Paris blocking Brunswick. Now, Brunswick is stuck in the Argonne. Brunswick then proceeded to camp at Landres, and interestingly enough, his troops got dysentery from eating green apples in the area, and that forced his army to have to rest in Landres. Meanwhile, during this time, Kellermann's army in the south had orders to link up with Dumouriez to stop Brunswick. The two armies linked up at Saint-Menehould on the 19th of September. Now, Brunswick wanted a battle, so he advanced onto Valmy and Saint-Menehould, but then was ordered to retreat due to the Prussian king's orders. But at this moment, Kellermann took the initiative and advanced, and caught the Prussians at Valmy. Now, the pitched battle was about to begin. And this pitched battle at Valmy started with the French cannons dueling the Prussian cannons. And the infantry just stood. There was no real infantry fighting in this battle. As the duel continued, the French Ribeville guns would prove better. Although the Prussian regular infantry were trained and experienced, they could probably easily defeat the French infantry, but the French citizen army dug in to defend Valmy at all costs. patriotic fever threw the men into the revolutionary zeal, and combined with General Kellermann riding on his horse with his hat on his sword crying, "Vive la nation!" Now combine this with all the French soldiers singing the Marseillaise. This gave the Prussian army the message that we should probably dip. So Brunswick retreated without a real fight, and the French proved to be victorious. Now the Prussians didn't actually retreat because of the Marseillaise and the French soldiers singing, no. But there were real problems with logistics and supplies that the Prussians didn't really want to face. So the Prussians had to retreat. Plus, there was a conflict going on in the east, which I'll also get to later. Anyway, the Battle of Valmy and its aftermath have earned it one of the spots as one of the most important battles in world history. The victory of Valmy saved Paris and made the people confident enough to declare a republic just 2 days later, abolishing the almost 1,000-year-old monarchy. The famous writer Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, who accompanied the Prussian army, would later say, "Here and today, a new epoch in the history of the world has begun, and you can boast you are present at its birth." Now, Brunswick was not pursued, mostly due to Dumouriez making negotiations with the enemy, and instead, the attention for the French army turned to Belgium once again. The Belgian plan would restart, all over again. Though the French victory at Valmy was the much-needed victory the young republic needed, the French still had a lot more to accomplish in the coming days. 5 days after Valmy, the Austrians under Albert Casimir, Duke of Teschen, were getting bored of raiding the French border towns, and with his army of 13,800, he besieged the French city of Lille. Lille was one of the most important cities in the north of France, and his fortress was one of the most formidable in the area. Now, sieges during this period would involve long periods of artillery bombardment, using howitzers and the digging of trenches. Hollow iron balls filled with gunpowder would be fired from the howitzer into the fort. Now, these balls would explode because there's a fuse at the top of the ball. But sometimes the fuse would go out, and you can take this fuse out by, like, splashing water on it. But you have to be careful, because when the balls explode, large pieces of iron would fly in all different directions, killing many and injuring many. Now, most sieges would end due to low morale, hunger, and the defenders running out of ammunition. Meanwhile, the siege of Lille was going on, Nice was captured from the Kingdom of Sardinia. And finally, on the 8th of October, the siege of Lille was lifted, as Teschen retreated because he was in a vulnerable position due to the Duke of Brunswick retreating. More good news came on the 16th of October when the siege of Thionville was also lifted. Meanwhile, in the Rhineland, the Armée de Rouen had been making slow progress. But then General Luckner has been replaced. He was replaced by Adam Philippe, Comte de Custine, and on the 18th of October, Mainz was besieged by Custine. Mainz joined the coalition as it was a small secularized state controlled by bishops and the aristocracy. So that was basically the main enemy of the revolution. So as Brunswick retreated, the coalition armies left the fortress of Mainz vulnerable. Mainz would surrender just 4 days later, without a fight. But the important part of this siege of Mainz was the fact that the German citizens of Mainz, who were fiercely opposed to the French and their occupation, actually accepted the French as their liberators and not as conquerors. The first time ever, Mainz became a free republic. German journalist Jörg Foster helped organize the young Mainz Republic, and later said, "The freedom of the press finally reigns within these walls where the printing press was invented." The Armée de Rouen would continue under Custine, and he would capture Speyer and Frankfurt, and would relatively stay dormant till 1793. Now, Dumouriez was not quiet during this time, but instead, he had been planning for a large campaign to take place in Belgium, specifically Flanders. Now, this is the start of the Flanders campaign. Dumouriez advanced onto Mons and met the Austrian army under Teschen at Jemappes. The Austrian army had numbered around 14,000 troops, but they were experienced, well-supplied, and disciplined. They faced over 40,000 French troops, but many were inexperienced, but still very enthusiastic and patriotic. Dumouriez would send his men in an uncoordinated attack, attacking the Austrian lines. But under the Duc de Chartres, the French had finally gained a foothold in the Austrian lines. With the French troops also advancing near the Austrian rear, Teschen and his army retreated. The French have won the Battle of Jemappes. The victory at Jemappes was a great victory. The Austrian Netherlands would collapse and be quickly overrun by the French, and the revolutionary government became more confident in their ability to wage war. Dumouriez's plan had finally worked. Now, the last major action of 1792 was under General Houchard, who led a small detachment from the Armée de Lorraine. Houchard would run into Brunswick's Prussian army at Limburg an der Lahn. Brunswick was planning to attack Custine near Frankfurt, and had decided to camp at Limburg. Unexpectedly, Houchard had caught the Prussians off guard and bombarded them where they camped. The Prussians would retreat once again while the French occupied Limburg, fortifying it. Now, aside from a small failed French expedition to the island of Sardinia, the conflict had died down. Near the end of 1792, the Prussian and Austrian armies were now planning and reorganizing once again to retake the Rhine territories and Belgium. Now, before I go into the year 1793, it is very important to mention the events unfolding in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth during this time. Sadly, Poland-Lithuania was partitioned for the first time in 1772. Poland-Lithuania was a weak state and had a corrupt nobility and parliament that was easily bought by foreign powers, and to make worse, Poland-Lithuania had an elective monarchy. So when nobles voted for a new monarch, foreign powers simply just bought out the nobles to get a king who was favorable to their demands. These conditions eventually led to Prussia, Austria, and Russia to take the first bit of Polish lands. In 1791, the Polish people had enough and declared a new constitution, the first one in Europe. But then Russia was pissed. Pissed. That Poland was trying to reform and in response fought a war with Poland in 1792. The war was fought well by Joseph Poniatowski, and the Poles fought admirably well. But then the Polish king signed off a peace favorable to the Russians. He would also join the Targowice Confederation, opposing the constitution. He was joined by the Polish nobility, hoping to gain back their power by helping the Russians. Now, this trend of Russian interference would cause a second partition beginning in 1793. With the Polish parliament being bought out by the Russians by approving to give massive amounts of land to Prussia and Russia. The king and the supporters of the Targowice Confederation didn't expect another partition. The people of Poland and Lithuania only felt more betrayed and outraged. This would set the stage for a major uprising in 1794, which we'll get to in just a bit. The year is 1793. France controls Belgium and a few cities on the Rhine. Dumouriez had been given orders to defend Belgium from the eventual coalition offensive, but instead of following orders from the government, he would begin his invasion of the Netherlands to install a Frenchified Republic. The French army would also be joined by the Belgic Legion, a unit of Belgian volunteers, and a Batavian Legion, a unit of Dutch Republican volunteers. On the 21st of January, Louis XVI, the French king, was guillotined. And now, pretty much all of Europe is now mad at France. Who would have guessed? What turned into an average war turned into a European crusade to end the revolution. And in the next couple of months, literally all of Europe will join against France.